Oh, I was trying all the gadgets here, whichever works. With no internet, so the
yes.
Geo signal was weak, so I tried now Vodafone. Well, let's see. Okay,
we'll go on live.
Should we go on live now?
Yeah. We can. Yeah,
we are already live. I think we'll just give a minute or two for people to join in. You can see below people, participants joining in. So we'll just give about a minute or two to them for them to join in. Yeah. Everything is okay for everyone?
Fine.
Yeah, we're fine.
We are able to hear, I think.
I think we are about 156 participants, I can see at the moment.
Yes. Since we have registrations up to 500, so we'll just give a minute for them to all join. I think we have about 173 people. Should we start? And you know, by the time we introduce all the panelists and all, I think most of the people will be there.
Yeah.
Yes, I think we can.
Okay, great. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
My name is Anita Raghunath, publisher of Elevate World India magazine, a premium magazine for the vertical transportation industry. And I'm also the director of Virgo Communications and Exhibitions, a company based out of Bangalore. Our team has been serving the vertical transportation industry since 2007 with first of its kind dedicated publications and exhibitions in India and some other emerging countries like South Africa, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. The series of webinars dedicated to the elevator industry by Virgo is also a first of its kind initiative, and we are extremely pleased to host them and support the vertical transportation industry and create this opportunity to connect and communicate with hundreds of people from across the world. I extend a warm welcome to all our esteemed panel members from the real estate and the architect fraternity and our moderator, Mr. Krishna Kumar. And of course, a warm welcome to all the attendees. Thank you for joining us today. COVID-19 pandemic has created an unprecedented global crisis. And you know, it is difficult for anyone today to understand or even anticipate what this pandemic will bring to our lives or to our business going forward. It has definitely changed at least the way we interact with people or spaces. Hence, it is important for all of us to accept the situation and to adapt to the required changes and the new social norm. The key objective of today's webinar is to understand COVID-19 impact on the real estate and construction industry and the anticipated shift in design, occupant density, and of course, the customer demand post this pandemic, and how these anticipated changes will impact our vertical transportation industry in India. I'm extremely delighted to share that we have today with us very eminent panelists with profound knowledge and experience in their respective field, and they will be discussing and sharing their point of views on the key issues and challenges of our industry. We are sure this will be an insightful and meaningful discussion, and all our attendees will have many ideas and thoughts to take back, to dwell upon, and even to implement. Without any further delay, let me introduce our panelist, and let me start with Mr. Mohan Abhichandani. Mr. Mohan Abhichandani is a director, project, real estate division at K. Raheja Corp. He is in charge of engineering functions for real estate commercial division of Raheja on pan-India basis. He's a BTEC by qualification and has rich experience of more than 40 years in the sectors like infrastructure, cement, telecommunication, power, oil and gas, and chemical. He joined K. Raheja Corp as director project from Reliance Communication Limited, and he was working as a head infrastructure business. He also had the additional responsibility as chief technical executive for Reliance Infratel Limited. Welcome, Mr. Mohan. Thank you for being here. Let me move on. My next panelist is Mr. Jay Kumar. He's the managing director, the executive board, RMZ Corp. He is a civil engineer graduate from Mysore University. He's also undergone real estate management program from Harvard Business School in finance, design, and leadership. He has been working in the real estate development projects covering residential, leisure, and predominantly commercial development since 30 plus years. Many premium landmark commercial developments, including the recent one, an integrated IT park, RMZ Eco World at Bangalore, are developed under his leadership. Welcome, Mr. Jaikumar.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next panelist is Mr. K. Mukundraj. He's the president and CEO real estate business at Raymond Group. He's a top management professional with more than 30 years of experience in the real estate, engineering, and project management. Prior to Raymond, he worked with various corporate and other organizations like L&T and Reliance Group. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for accepting our invitation and being here.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Our next panelist is Mr. Rana Ram, an experienced architect at RSP Design Consultants. He graduated from Chandigarh College of Architecture in 1984, worked in Delhi for 18 years with internationally famous architectural firm, Raj Rewal Associates. He then shifted to Bangalore in 2002 and joined RSP Consulting.
Hello, everybody.
Yes, welcome, sir. Our next panelist is Mr. Kumaran W.R. He's the Senior Vice President, Design and Development at Virtuous Reality. He holds a Bachelor of Engineering from PhD College of Technology, Coimbatore. He's also completed a certificate course of HBX from Harvard Business School. Mr. Kumaran has 20 years of experience in construction industry and virtuous reality. He was responsible for design, construction, and delivery of virtuous reality flagship projects such as VR Mall Bangalore, VR Chennai. Kumaran also supervised the delivery of VR Surat Virtuous Reality 2. He started his career with Larsen & Toubro as a graduate engineering trainee, where he was a part of several key projects, was recognized as one of the top performers and nominated into L&T's management leadership program. Welcome, sir.
Thanks, Anita. My pleasure.
Our next panelist is Mr. Nilesh Dongre, architect, head developer space at Edifice Consultants. Nilesh Dongre is a senior associate at Edifice and heads the developer vertical. He leads a team which caters to most of the eminent names from the real estate industry. An eternal learner, he has hands-on approach to projects. He believes in being equipped to cater to the commercial demands of the project while having a sustainable and human approach to design. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Anita.
Yes. Our next panelist is Mr. Jatin Shah. He's the National Director at Colliers International. Jatin is an experienced project management professional with an architectural degree from School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. And he also holds a master's in building engineering and management. His forte remains pre-construction, and he has handled projects across all asset class in India and countries like Serbia, Malaysia, Rwanda, etc. At Colliers, he's handling technical aspect of development and also heads the technical due diligence team. I welcome all my panelists once again, and thank you for being here.
Yes.
Thank you.
Let me go to our moderator. I know most of you know him, but let me have the pleasure of introducing him. He's Mr. Krishna Kumar, President and CEO of PAV and Associates from Chennai. PAV and Associates is one of the leading elevator consulting firm in India, fondly called KK. He's a mechanical engineer, joined Otis Elevator Company as a graduate engineer trainee, and was trained in installation, testing, and commissioning of elevators. After successful tenure in sales and installation in Otis KK, moved to Mitsubishi Elevators, where he handled Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Joined PV and Associates in 2009 and spending close to 11 years in the elevator industry. He's passionate and committed leader, driving PV and Associates to greater heights through best-in-class customer service and reliable partnership. Thank you so much, KK. I think the floor is yours. Please take it forward.
Thank you, Anita, and good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I have a panelist with a very impressive profile here today. And I'm sure the audience, especially the elevator industry, people would be delighted to hear from them. For the next 1 hour, we are going to engage with them to find out their views, opinions, and expectations that would directly or indirectly impact the way the vertical transportation industry operates in light of the COVID-19 situation. Amidst all the negative news that we have been hearing for the past 40 days, I would like to begin this session on a positive note. A Collier statement, that I read recently states that the office space absorption in 2019-20 was around 50 million square feet, and that the demand for 2021 will fall just about 40-45 million square feet, primarily because there has been little business the first quarter of this year. Let's now find out from our expert panelists how things are going to shape up for the vertical transportation industry. I have this question to ask everyone in this panel and seek their views. And I begin with Mr. Mohan Abhichandani. Sir, the question to you is, social staffing becoming the norm, the occupant densities in the buildings will see drastic reduction. Do you consider this a positive sign? And what impact do you foresee in the vertical transportation systems?
See, the vertical transportation system, the way we have been operating, we always wanted to have more and more people in the our lift car. We wanted more and more speed, and the occupation per square foot was increasing. Now that whole thing is reversed now. Now we are talking about social distancing. We are talking about the if at all we start our projects and if we start again our leasing patterns, then whole thing has to really go for a change. Now this will of course not be sustainable. So we have to have a plan for next 1.5 or 2 years what we are going to do, and I hope that within next 1.5 or 2 years we will be coming back to the same situation what we are today. That's what I hope. Now, what are the changes to be done in next for working for next 1 and 1.5 year? That is to be seen. So how to reduce the people going inside in the lift, how we can keep the safe distances, how we can reduce the density of the square foot area which has been already leased out, how to retain that will be the major factor which will govern the future business.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Jaykumar, what is your view on this?
Yeah, good morning, everyone. First of all, the vertical transportation or the elevators, you know, what we are discussing now, we view elevator as an opportunity for everyone to experience. Just to, you know, give a background, any person who, uses a commercial building or a residential building has to have an experience of elevator in the sense, you know, there is always a direct interaction of end user with the elevators. Unlike other equipments like chillers or DGs, which we incorporate, the elevator is the one very important factor in any of the building, which is, it comes in direct contact with the end user. So that is the prime focus. We look at not just as an elevator for a vertical transportation, we look at how the experience of the end user is enhanced through elevator. That's the, you know, basic of our understanding of vertical transportation system. Coming next to your question, the density, you know, dynamics that's happening because of this COVID situation, I think we have to get ourselves prepared for a short-term impacts and long-term impacts. Long-term, I agree with Mr. Mohan that the situation is going to come back to normal. It's not that it's going to remain as it is. That's what we all believe. But there will be some short-term impact. We don't know whether it is next 6 months or 8 months. There is going to be a short-term impact wherein we also see not only the density is coming down, we also see a balancing factor of many companies will opt for a work from home. When people opt for work from home, naturally the density in the office usage as it is comes down. That brings down a little bit pressure on the elevator operations. So that balancing, the whole dynamics of operation as a commercial asset is going to change. With that, we see not much of a problem in handling the number of people that's going to operate in the elevator. But yes, short-term planning has to be there. Social distancing has to be there. There will be some inconvenience. That's my view on this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Mr. Kumaran, you've been handling a lot of retail spaces. Can you just give your opinion on this, your views on this reduction in densities?
Sure. So in a retail, the main purpose of having these vertical transportation is how we push people from either the parking level to the retail floors. The lesser the duration is the beneficial for us, because we want them to spend maximum time of their time in the center on the retail floors, not in the parking lot. I'm not going to see any change in the design pattern which we are going to use. Still, the number of escalators and the elevators will remain the same, because when we design, let it be the high side or even the vertical transportation load, we design it for the maximum of the peak. Issues like these are short-term impact, and they are not going to have a long-term impact on any of the designs which we are going to implement. That's point A. Point B is, yes, we may have to re-strategize in terms of looking at the usage of the elevators, because as Jaikumar was telling, these are interactive equipments. They are not like chillers which are sitting at some level. You can feel the effect of chiller by the way of conditioned air inside the retail center, but not your interacting. But lifts, yes, there are physical interaction of the customers, the end users. We may have to look at how we sanitize them, the social distancing, the elevator capacity may still remain the same, but actually you will be restricting people. And that's only a short term in terms of, let's say, 6 months to a year. So, as far as the retail design is concerned, I'm not going to see any change in the near future.
Thank you, Mr. Kumaran. Mr. Jatin, no, you've been a development manager for many years.
Yeah.
What is your view on this?
On the so your question pertaining was on the impact on the retail retail model with respect to elevators and escalators, right?
Yeah.
So primarily, as Mr. Kumaran said, in a retail format or retail design, the movement of people are mostly by means of escalators. Mostly. Most of the time, the escalators are positioned in such a manner that the movement of vertical, whether it's on upper level or ground level, is all centered around the central retail space or arena. And that's how the movement is transitioned. So I don't see any impact on the retail design coming per se from the usage of an escalator or an elevator, because elevators are primarily still used by people who are either going to the box office directly or to the parking floors directly, right? And mostly, yes, increasingly there will be usage of staircases which might come in because of situation which has come up due to COVID-19. But from a planning perspective, from a retail design perspective, the requirements of escalators and elevators will still continue to remain the same. We might see some increase in the capacities of elevators in the retail spaces because of the social distancing norms. So we might have some larger, deeper or cars to get in more number of people, because with the social distancing coming in, the crowding in the elevator might also get reduced. It won't be the earlier cases where a lot of people were used to crowd together and get into the elevator together. That impact might be seen in initial coming months or initial coming quarters, where people will refrain from getting it crowded. So the requirement of elevators, not so much in the retail perspective, but probably in other real estate formats, might have a slight impact. But these are all what you call predictions, and we are really not seeing any kind of, we have to wait for how things come up, actually. So that's my take on this particular when it comes to retail industry.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mukundraj, you know, the social distancing, how is it going to play a role in the residential buildings? I don't see much of a change except in the lobbies and other common spaces.
Yeah. When it comes to residential, in fact, the criteria that we have in designing or configuring vertical transportation, the travel time and the waiting, they are not really the criteria which go into sizing as well as the numbers of elevators. So the only issue which is going to come up there is the social distancing at the lobby level. But again, except the peak morning time when people are going to the office or the school, and the evening time, except this, peaks, which are just about half an hour to 45 minutes, I think there could be some issues with social distancing. But what I believe is people will slowly get adjusted to maintaining the required distancing and trying to take the required precautions on themselves, and may not really make much of a change on the design or sizing of either the lobby nor the vertical transportation system for the residential part of it.
Thank you very much. Mr. Rana, what is your view as an architect?
On this, I see, when I say especially the residential parts, residential is basically, as Mr. Gupun said, I think there's not a lot of rush, and the time travel and other issues are not there. But at the same time, I think when we design the housing, well, people generally, like in the morning and evening, there will be rush. So social distancing will be still an issue, I think, which has to be managed at the management level, or how you manage it at the distinct level. But in my opinion, when as an architect, I think if somebody gives me option, I will move more horizontal than vertical, so that to avoid going very high. Like if you see the, I don't know if people know the Chandigarh model. If you see the Chandigarh housing, especially up to 5-story, they have been giving good ramps. People of all ages, they walk up and down, they use the ramps, social distancing, not an issue. Lifts are used, but only for handicap and wheelchair access people. So the building up to, say, you know, 15, 17 meter height, that manageability is there. But at the same time, then I think the option, with that kind of option, will not exist more for the developer, like in Bangalore and the high-rise cities. So issue of social distance is another part. Second, I see when you say higher category flats, if you say, I say 3,000 square feet flats, I can certainly design some flat, think of a tower, which is more like a duplex tower. So you reduce the number of stops, but at the same time, people go into their houses and start using the staircases inside. So they communicate more inside rather than outside. So that could be one of the design aspects which kind of play can be done, which may not have much of the, I think, only thing is the adaptability of the developers, that how they adapt the model, how they see it as a, you know, selling point in terms of their, you know, the marketability. That's the way I take it as. I think essentially that's the kind of thing. So that's the take on housing. Housing has a very limited option, I feel. Yes.
Thank you very much. Ms. English, especially in office spaces, what is your opinion?
Yeah, so firstly, to begin with, I do understand there is this additional emphasis which is happening that the densities would go down. I understand that the densities would go down, but they would not go down significantly to have a major impact. The 10 square meter business that's being written in the National Building Code, I don't think that it is going to be going down further than that. The buildings would still be designed. But how we design buildings to handle those kind of densities is going to be impact. So it's a change which comes in terms of planning. When I talk about vertical transportation, we primarily look at handling capacity and waiting intervals is what has been sorted. I think that the waiting interval is something that's going to be getting an additional emphasis henceforth. Rather than looking at larger elevators, we will be looking at smaller elevators, because you don't want to crowd them. We all know that when you run a analysis, it runs on the fact that the cars are 80% loaded to the capacity of an elevator. So you would like to rather go for smaller elevator, reduce the amount of waiting intervals, so that there are more number of elevators happening at a more frequent opportunity. Give those elevators lesser number of floors to serve, so that have lesser destinations, and you don't have people waiting in the lobby for that. You don't have to make them wait for that. And if at all there is that kind of a situation, the aisle spaces start increasing. We look at alternate floors being dealt by elevators, so that people can walk down one floor. The offices, buildings which are designed at the moment, we deal with staircases as only means of fire escape. They are not considered as a way of vertical transport. We are talking about only elevators and escalators here. They are mechanical ways, but there are manual ways that you can walk down a stair. You can climb up one floor. So if you start programming that on, say, alternate floors, the load on vertical transportation becomes that much lesser. Everybody can climb down one floor. Climbing up is a problem. So we make staircases accessible. I think it's not taking a straight impact that the density is just going to be higher and it's going to be straight increase in terms of elevators or the car size increasing. But these novel ways of how we are going to be trying to use these spaces is something that's going to be starting to come in picture.
Thank you Thank you, Mr. Nilesh.
No, Mr. Kumar, I have one more idea. Can I just interrupt one thing? Just in the office spaces, when we say office spaces, I think it was a good suggestion, use the staircase. But I think some of the recent projects we tried, people are now preferring to have escalator between the floor to floor. Like if I say I have a building of 10 story, I take 4 floors in the building. I generally use the lift to reach the 4th floor, but I internally am using escalator to go up and down.
Very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
So that has become like quite a good thought, because if you see when we are designing all Infosys, so Infosys has made like a module. They are saying, okay, fire escape stake is the requirement of the fire people. Okay, do it. At the same time, we want to have a communication through the escalator. Do give us alternate escalator to every floor, so people don't feel lazy to go up and down. They just go there. Social distancing is not an issue. I think moving up and down is not an issue. But only thing is the space. Again, is the space. It's a longer space. So that could be one point which I think we might have to think, but it could be a good thought also ongoing. And especially when you want to pick the people from the basement to the lobbies, parking to the lobbies, escalator should be taken like a transit. In case of a transit elevator, it should be like escalator. Okay, put the people onto the lobby with the escalator. Straight away, many of the issues of social distancing, fast movement, it can be solved faster and better. That's the way we are doing now. Two buildings we are planning like that with Infosys.
Yeah, at least for the parking and the basements, escalators should be a good norm to proceed.
Yes, and normally when Infosys work, they have the food courts, they have everything. So they are putting escalator everywhere. They are saying, okay, communicate the space with the escalator. So the people don't, one is the laziness of people. Sometimes people feel, oh, we'll go to the staircase, open the door, go inside the well. Staircase is not well lit and well maintained. So these kind of things. So we have done, like even with the KRC, Mr. Vinod Rohida has given us a very good suggestion. We are trying to develop a building which will have escalator as an alternate floor. They will connect the alternate floor with the escalators. Lifts are there for the fire norms. They will be there as a fire norms. They will continue to have evacuation systems. But escalator might become the choice of the people to communicate. That's the way we are thinking. Yes.
Now, I have a question for Mr. Mohan and Mr. JK. This, assuming that the work from home will not continue for a very long time, looking at many limitations it's got, it's a very, optimistic view. So buildings still continue to be developed. Do you see this less denser buildings creating an opportunity for more demand for space?
Sorry, I didn't hear the last word, you said.
Do you see less denser buildings create an opportunity for more demand for space, and which means more
elevation? No, I don't think so. I don't think so, because if the density is reduced, then the cost will go up for everybody. And I don't think so. Any company at this moment is ready to spend extra money. The other, everybody is trying to save on what they are doing. So I don't think so at the moment that will be any beneficial. It's okay that maybe if they retain the existing building by reducing the density, and most of the people or the people who can be very productive from work from home can be, the company is going to decide of the some people who are required to come to office or who are required to remain at home. And that way they are going to divide it. And I don't think so anybody will be ready to pay for more space in this kind of situation. I don't think so. Any commercial, nobody is ready to pay. Rather, they will be talking to reduce the rental or something like that. I don't know, but that's my my commercial people. But that's the norm now. Everybody wants to save.
Mr. JK, your opinion on that?
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Mohan. Because, all the end users, whether it's an IT company or any software development company, they all look at cost per seat. And this pressure on the economics and their business model is not only for real estate, it is across all the companies, all the categories. So definitely there will be a cost pressure on end users as well. I don't think there will be a more demand because of this social distancing and less denser building. But they will balance it out maybe with a work from home concept like that. That's our take on that. But they will look at elevators from a different angle, like how do you make elevators as a more touchless interface? How can we improve the hygiene of the car? and how do you improve the indoor air quality of the elevator car? Those might be the questions that may crop up from the end user. Not on the demand side, we don't foresee any change.
See, the main, Krishna Kumar, the main challenge at this moment is, one thing is you design the new building, like Rana was saying, that design a new building with elevators, combination of elevators and escalators and all that. That's for the new buildings. How do we improve the existing building? That's the biggest challenge now for us. So how I make it, you know, touchless entry, touchless elevators, and how I should be doing that is becoming a main challenge now, how to improve the air quality, other things for the existing buildings, because finally the existing buildings has to be occupied again once this lockdown is over. So that is becoming a big challenge now. Somebody, and I tell you one simple, somebody suggested a very good, I will call it, in Hindi we call it a jugaad. Okay. So he said that, okay, we do one thing, we take a piece of a sponge, okay, and stick it to the glue next to the your call buttons inside and outside, and put the toothpicks into that. And everybody who comes, he picks up one toothpick and press the button with the toothpick and throws in a dustbin. So he's become touchless now. So it was a good idea. It's okay. But it can, I don't know whether it can work or not, but this is what somebody said, that for immediately you can do existing buildings like that.
Yes.
Make it touchless.
Krishna Kumar, can I just add something here?
Please.
Yeah. I was just talking to a couple of people having their offices in China. China has now seen their sort of post-COVID situation transiting from the post-COVID to what would be the new normal for them. Now, what they say is, in this particular transition period, because nobody is able to make changes to the interiors of the offices, because the offices were designed as per the old normal with the number of whatever distance and the densities and all that, nobody is going to be spending money in recasting the interiors. They have taken a call, at least for the next 3 months, all the major companies occupying large floor plates of offices have migrated to a rota system, wherein every alternate desk is what comes over to the office to work on a particular day, and then there is by rotation somebody else comes in. In the process, they have continued to use the same office to continue their business. Likewise, because the number of people who are coming in have reduced, they have also resorted to a much more spread staggering of the timings of the office. Like, assuming it is a multi-tenanted facility, there is an understanding with the developer or whoever is a facility manager on staggering the time of individual floors. In the process, they are staggering the in time as well as the out time. So they have managed to use existing office by maintaining social distancing without changing any of the parameters or looking at incurring any additional cost on it. So maybe this experience of China, which is seeing the post-COVID or seeing the post-COVID, could get replicated across the world. So I personally feel nothing much may happen. Only thing is, yes, like Mr. Jay Kumar said, touchless panels and all that sort of a technological interventions could come in. But with regard to the number of elevators or the densities or office, I think it's just the transition of 6-9 months. I think we should be back to the normal. That's my viewpoint.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very encouraging and very optimistic. And now Mr. Jatin was mentioning about using large elevators, especially for the new buildings. Do you see the design being considered would now have a drastic change in the densities that are being considered, and bigger elevators would be used? What is your opinion on using 20 passenger, 26 passenger and 30 passenger capacities?
So as Mr. Mukundraj mentioned just now, this is a phase of 6 months to 9 months, or maybe lesser than that, where we are talking about situations where people will be, you know, people are talking about less density. But I am sure we are going to go back to old times where the densities will remain at about 90 or 100 square feet of sale area. So the number of elevators or the sizing of the elevators are still being driven by the models which all of you run.
to help us and identify the capacities of the elevators. With the densities increasing, we were already seeing the capacities of the elevators going up from a 20 passenger to a 24 passenger or a, you know, that kind or a 22 passenger, if that's something which you're talking about. So in addition to the staircases, in addition to the changes in the overall design, which are going to come up architecturally, I think the sizing of the elevators at 24 passengers is just remaining going to be optimal, because beyond that, the larger sized elevators in the longer run are not going to be very functional. They are not actually going to be usable from that perspective. Once even when we return back to, you know, hopefully we'll find a vaccine and everyone will be safe. And similar situation might come up in future also where a similar virus is again found. But the cute point here is to identify a solution in the current design, which is related to making sure the air movements are right inside elevator, making sure that people are screened properly, making sure that within the elevator there are some kind of UV scanners which are available, making sure that at the entrance to the building to going up to the elevator and taking an elevator up is all contactless. So this innovations, I'm sure the elevator industry is already working on. And if you ask me, Krishnakumar, it's my view is that we will probably stay to around 24 passenger and not bring a higher capacity elevators. So that's what I feel as of now.
Thank you very much. So Mukundraj, coming to residential buildings, I think capacities have a very negative effect, because the cost is going to go up, your maintenance cost is going to go up. And how do you think you'll be handling this situation? I think, do you intend reducing the, especially in high-rise buildings in Bombay, where capacity also matters?
As I said earlier, Krishnakumar, this COVID, whatever experience that we are all having with a slight protected lifestyle, we are trying to ensure we don't really come in contact with anybody. We try and maintain some distance. There are certain precautionary measures that we all take. So these will, as I said, will continue to be, I would say, the norm for, as I said, 6 to 9 months. But when it comes to residential, I am not expecting any change to really happen in terms of the numbers or capacities of the elevators, because generally you see in residential, mostly the high-rise type of buildings, that there is a good amount of, I would say, redundancy available in its capacity. So people are going to slightly adjust to the new norm with the scarce capacity of vertical transportation that is going to be available. Because beyond that, an impact, for a developer, it is a capex, but when it comes to the life cycle cost, the residents are going to be bearing a cost if there is any enhancement, which I don't think will become viable. So I'm not expecting much change happening with regard to particularly the vertical transportation in the residential buildings. The only thing which will happen, where I also believe the DCRs will also look at it positively and provide a bit of support to the developers, the lobby area, the main lift lobby, as well as the entrance lobby area, where in certain DCRs, there are certain restrictions on the maximum size beyond which it gets computed within the FSI. I think there some relaxations will be provided by the respective municipalities and the town planning authorities, which will enable a slightly more liberal sizing of these lobbies, which will enable people don't crowd up in a small congested area.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Mukul. See, I have a very very different question this time. I would like to ask this to Mr. Nilesh. Do you see a shift in this situation, people going and developing more commercial buildings than residential buildings?
Well, I don't really think so. I think that the residential development is right now going to have a bit of a pause, a bit of a intervention to check whether there is a requirement and how the market is behaving. Because right now we are in a flux. We are saying that this is going to be there for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. Your guess is as good as mine, is a situation that we have at the moment. So residential is something that is going to get paused because it's all related to what's happening to people, their jobs, their livelihoods, and everything is all of it is getting connected. Commercial demand will continue as it was. There may be a slight dip, which I think is just a notional, just for the momentary dip, but things will get back to normal soon. Residential may take a little bit of a pause, but it will gain the momentum again in some.
Thank you.
Yeah, Krishnakumar, I have a view on this between residential versus commercial. If you look at commercial real estate is a driver for residential development. You know, a job created means 100 square feet commercial development is creates one job, and that job demands a residential development of 5 to 6 times of that. That's the driver, and both are linked, and always a commercial demand is an indication to drive the residential demand. And also in times of, you know, when the crisis like this, when the market bounces back, it is expected commercial real estate bounces back first, followed by the residential.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. I have a very different question now. I would like to ask Mr. Rana,
yes,
do you see the buildings going horizontal, like you said earlier, than going vertical?
I see that actually, but that I can imagine in the maybe B grade cities and C grade cities, because where the people might think, but only I think not only this virus, I think we might have few more viruses coming in the future. We might have this kind of geopolitical situation. So that kind of thinking might prevail. Like even if go to the B grade cities, people still prefer, I want to be near to the ground. I want to be G+4. I want to be G+5. So that kind of building, that's why I gave example of Chandigarh. If you see Chandigarh, the entire city, entire housing, almost like less than 15 meter everywhere. And that model in Chandigarh has been doing, but only thing is if the influx of population in Chandigarh now, it is spread on to Mohali, it gone to Panchkula because they had a restriction on these kind of things. So I see in B and C grade cities, horizontal movement might pick up so that there is an option for the people to move up and down individually. That's why I said Chandigarh is working on many housing. I saw there are ramps in that. So it works very nicely. They were effective, old people, small kids, everybody, you know, playingly, jollingly, they keep up and down, and it works. It is working. That's the way I think at it, yes.
Thank you very much. Now, I want to ask Mr. Kumaran, because you're part of the Zander Group as well. See, most of the developers are concentrating on the metros. As Mr. Rana said, do you think this is an opportunity to develop all the peripheral parts of the city, or going to the tier 2 or tier 3 cities, or the rural side, where you have a lot of space and need not go tall, and you know that actually improves the demand for escalators.
Yes.
Social distancing and all that can be managed much better with escalators.
So KK, that's a very nice question. First and foremost is, even if you are ready, it's the overall infrastructure as a city, as a town, which is available in the place. Right, that chucks out the demand for people willing to move to these tier 2 or tier 3 cities. There has been instances where some of the IT companies have taken a bold decision, wanted to create campuses in far-flung places, tier 2 and tier 3 cities. There are many examples which are still not occupied by their own captive teams. So to this question, there is no direct answer to say that would we be interested to go there directly. It all depends on the demand. The demand creates the supply. At this point of time, I don't think, other than the metros and good tier 2 cities which are capable to take that kind of demand, we would be interested. I also wanted to add one point which Mukund was telling to your earlier question, that in residential, it's not going to see any change in the vertical transportation. Even for retail, also I have touched this point. Maybe the re-strategize, which I told, is you would have For example, in the typical floor plate of retail, you have two escalator banks and two elevator banks based on the floor plates. The one which is closer to the multiplex, that is where the maximum demand happens. So we may have to relook in resizing that elevator bank and the one which is straight away opposite. Of course, KK, you work with us for many projects, you know these details. We would resize in terms of reducing that and increasing on the elevator bank, which is towards the multiplex. On escalator banks, I don't think there's going to be any change at all. Yes, in the way these are maintained or how we create the level of sanitization which any customer is going to see, yes, that is where we are going to focus a lot.
Thanks very much. I have a very interesting question now. I think I will ask Vicky. See, the demand for space currently is not very encouraging. Okay, we hope that things will change and things will change for the better in the future, maybe in 3-4 months or 5 months or 6 months. We don't know exactly when this is going to happen. So there's going to be a lot of stress on the pricing. And do you think it is going to be sustainable for you to look at imported equipment, or you want to patronize Indian products, or you still will patronize products coming from China in spite of all this backlash happening?
Yeah, interesting question. This, you know, time is very, very, you know, not a proper this thing to talk about cost now, because we don't know the impact exactly how it is going to have. Yes, there is any developing economies like India, there will be always a pressure on cost. Okay, that being the case, but India is slowly coming out of, you know, developing economy to a developed economy. That is in the transition period, in my understanding. So there is not only it's a price sensitive, there is also now, like what I said, the elevator is a factor for experience of the people. People look at the quality aspect as well. So, and another angle to is this Make in India initiative. So India has to grow up. India has to, you know, produce product and on par or above par of international standards. And the patronage of Indian is always will be there across any companies. But also the developments are looking for a quality product. That's where, you know, some sort of balancing has to happen. Currently, if you ask me, definitely if I have a, you know, apple to apple comparison between what I get in India and what I get abroad or somewhere else, definitely we prefer Indian product.
Thank you. Mr. Mohan, what is your opinion? Because you've been buying so many elevators, you know, will you patronize Chinese products, or do you want to support Make in India?
See, I would definitely go for a Make in India. You're able to hear me. Sorry. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Yes. So I'll definitely go for Make in India, but that Make in India will not be possible with the immediate effect, because as of today, we have been buying so many elevators and I find that 50-60% of the component comes from China, Thailand and other countries. So now taking over that kind of production in India, that kind of technology, it is going to take time, but maybe after 1 or 2 years or 3 years, if we speed up our own manufacturing facilities and R&D, we will be able to match that kind of thing. But at the moment, yes, we have to depend on the elevators coming from China. Or we have no choice immediately, at least for next 1 or 2 years. After that, yes, definitely there's a good movement is going on that we should start Make in India. And that movement will get more momentum once this COVID lockdown is over. People will start thinking on that line now.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mohan. Mr. Kumaran, I have a very interesting question with the malls. Now, with all this online sales happening and you have this big companies pitching in, do you see a drastic change in the way the malls operate? Do you see a fall, resizing of the malls, smaller malls, footprint being reduced or anything like that?
There is not even one forum in which this question is not thrown at me. I want to give a basic comparison. The organized retail in India is at a very low percentage if you need to peg it in terms of benchmarking with other countries. In India, it is at 10%, whereas in US, which is at the far end of the spectrum, it is at 85%. And the highest volume, which is equal to India in terms of China, it's at 20%. So there is a lot of catching up which needs to be done even in India at the present rate if you need to meet even China. Malaysia, which is not comparable as size of what India is or China, but it is still at 55% of organized retail. Now, the way it is going to change is there's going to be a lot of synergy between online retail and brick and mortar retail, which is going to happen. Everyone is going to look at this situation as an opportunity that every store which is locked down, which is not serving any purpose, whether they can use it as a regular warehousing or a last mile delivery centers, even in their own brick and mortar retail, is what going to be thought through. I think people have already started discussing these strategies. They will evolve in the next 3 to 4 quarters, and going forward, this will be there. Somebody was telling me earlier, there is no normal anymore. There is going to be new normal, and that is going to be the normal going forward. So I think that's how it's going to be.
Thank you, Mr. Kumar. Now I have a question to Mr. Rana. See, you're all designers. So class A buildings generally have very high-end specifications. So yes. Built for the design. So with COVID-19, which is forcing the clients to cut down the frills, where do you think the customers would cut down? Will the elevators be one of the major points?
No, the way I look at it is, as a designer, I see a lot of impact happening onto the common areas. So okay. when I say common area, I say the moment I enter the building, I say at the entry point of the building, I have a lobby. After the lobby, I have a lift bank. So when I had to enter the lift bank, as I understand for the social distancing, I have a queue system now. I had to put the people in a queue one by one. They go inside and then they enter the building. At the same time, now the your points come to the picture. When I have to enter the lift bank, so I again have to make a queue there because the lifts are all, maybe 30 people are there, but the lifts are only say 6 lifts, 7 lifts. But again, you will have a queue there. So my space planning will have a lot of impact in terms of the common area when we say common area planning. So that kind of design in terms of, okay, classical building is some example, but at the end of the day, I more focus on the area which is more like a public spaces will have an enhancement now in terms of the square foot areas. In terms of when I enter the lift lobby, like general system is, 40 people standing in the lift lobby and waiting for the lift. That situation may not happen now because you may not allow 40 people to stand in the lift lobby. Because we used to give a 4 meter wide lift lobby, maybe 6 banks are there, 6 lifts are there. How to tackle that kind of rush now? Because that you cannot widen the lift lobby. If you have the present scenario, present building, you cannot do it. Future building, you can always do it. You can have lavish spaces. My take from this is that I have to somewhere make a little increase in the common area components. I might reduce my area, which is more like a reception area, more like a lounging area. That area might have to reduce. So impact will come into the common spaces. At the same time, when you guys are looking into your engineering, as a lift engineering, as a, planning for your lifts, you might have to think of, more other things like automation system. When the people go inside, you might have to think of, fumigation curtains. But how you maintain the social distance between the cabins, that is going to be a task for you guys. That how you take it, because your lift is a certain capacity, you say 8 passenger capacity lift, how you make it like a socializing space, I have no idea. Only thing is, okay, helps you is, you have at the entry point, you have curtains, you have a fumigation curtain from the top as well as from the bottom. The moment the person enter, he is fumigated from top to the bottom. And inside space, as a socializing space, does not matter that. That's the way I look at it. But my backspace is going to increase. My backspace in terms of common space, in terms of my lobby, in terms of my entry experience, I might have to hold, 30 people under the porch, making a queue. So those kind of spaces will inflate for me as a designer. That's the way I look at it.
Thank you. Mr. Nilesh, what is your opinion? This frills cutting, will it affect the elevators?
Not really. I agree with what Rana just said, that the common area spaces, the way we deal with the planning of it, the way we are going to handling the density, the waiting population, where people are going to we group together. Those spaces are what's going to be a challenge in terms of how we are going to be dealing in terms of planning. I don't see any other major impact coming up in terms of how the buildings are going to get designed.
Okay. Mr. Jatin, you know, now I have a question, taking what Mr. Rana and Mr. Nilesh said. So eating into the common areas and increasing the common areas, you always speak about efficiency, floor space efficiency.
Yeah.
So how do you think it will be handled?
The design efficiencies, KK will still remain a question which will be always asked to the architects to balance it out based on the overall, you know, ratios which we're talking about here. And that's what every tenant also looks into, see to it that their spaces are you know, utilized to the core extent. But yes, there is an increasing demand based on the number of elevators increasing, based on densities increasing. Already the demand for the lobby size had gone up. From earlier lobby sizing of a 3 meter or 3.5 meter wide, we are now talking about 4.5 to 5 meter wide lobbies, most of our projects as well. This will remain. Yes, in near future for 6-7 months, you will still see people lining up, queuing up, and you know, people using elevators, people not crowding the elevators. But I would say the sizing of the elevator lobbies are dependent on the densities which we're looking on, and we will continue to do the same thing. Today also the developer, if a new building is coming up, a developer wants to be always a future ready. So he's still going to design his building for a larger density. Maybe a lobby, or maybe a core, maybe a toilet core, maybe a number of staircases, et cetera, is going to be on a larger density, because this is not going to continue for eternity. It is going to end in future, right? We are talking about 6 to 9 months, which as all of us were talking about earlier, this is a short-term gap, and short-term situations with reduced work population coming to offices, we will still maintain the same social distancing norms. We will still maintain the same densities, and we will continue to work. So I, overall on a larger picture, I don't see much improvements on the, or much challenges on the areas which we're talking about here. The densities are going to remain the same. Every developer is going to design, because any retrofit at a later date is going to be more prohibitive or maybe not possible, rather than, you know, taking care of those situations today in the design. And a tenant might come up and say, still put a workstation at 120 square feet per person, which means lesser number of people. But tomorrow, a new tenant might come up and occupy the same space at a larger density of say 90 or 100 or 80, or maybe a BPO coming in. BPOs will still have to come to work. So a developer will always design his building to remain ahead of what is the prevailing norm. That's my take on this.
Thank you.
Can I add something to what Nilesh and Rana said on this? What I believe, particularly commercial offices, I think the emphasis from now on will move more towards the functionality and the future readiness of the building, like automation and smart offices or smart building concepts, rather than on the frills. So there will be issues with funding, with budgets. There will be constraints to spend beyond a particular point. But what I believe is, at least for the next couple of years, whatever new designs are going to evolve, or even where buildings are going to be completed, where the shell is done, where the buildings are going to be completed, I think the emphasis will be on making the building more functional, more future ready, rather than spend on exotic marble from floor to ceiling, that sort of, all that expenditure will come down. It'll be more emphasis on making it the right building rather than the good looking building.
Thank you. So now I have a interesting question that everybody has been talking about, touchless contacts and all that. I think I'll take this question with everybody so that let's get a bigger view, because there's a lot of Q&A is coming up from the audience also. So contactless access or contactless lifts, lift calling is the buzzword. Technologies are being offered, you know, by many. How sustainable do you think all this would be? Because any touchless, you know, would increase the waiting time. You know, you want a barrier-free access to the lift. You want a free-flowing traffic. So any system would actually be a deterrent to the movement of the traffic. How sustainable do you think? And is it a wise investment? I will ask this from Mr. Mohan. I'll start from Mr. Mohan.
As I told you earlier, that the main question at the moment is how to, you know, the existing buildings which has existing systems, how to make it touchless. Now, there are many ways of making it touchless without really spending the money, which I said, one is a toothpick or you give them a tissue paper, which is to be used. And these are the main things which we can start with and then migrate it to the touchless. Of course, touchless is going to be a future investment and for the new buildings. But existing buildings also, when I go to any, I think we have all the audience of the lift manufacturers are there. When we talk of any smallest change in any of the electrical panel or a control panel or anything, it costs us a bomb. The cost is the lift. They will be ready to bargain anything while selling the lift. But if you go and tell them, dear, I want one button to be changed now to make it touchless. Yes, they are going to give you a big fat bill for that, or the big quote we will get for that. So with that kind of things, I don't know we don't know whether how the whole market will going to behave now after the lockdown is over, how the companies are going to behave. And on that, if we want to spend the money for the touchless, the people have to come out with an innovative idea. All the lift manufacturers to come out with, I think, most economical, what the best we can do. Yes, then developers will definitely adopt it. But if they say, okay, now this is opportunity to, get the money out of them, then it's not possible because we don't have, our pockets are empty. We can't be spending any amount on that now. Unless my customer is ready to pay for it.
Okay. Mr. Kumaran, how sustainable do you think it is?
KK, as far as we are concerned at Virtuous Retail, many of our passenger lifts are manned. So, because this is a moving crowd, these are customers, the footfalls depends, and it also changes widely between the weekdays and the weekends. They are manned and every contact is going through only through the safety net. I don't see an immediate requirement that we move to contactless touch buttons until otherwise, like Mohan was telling. It's a fact that any breakdown parts, any worn-out machineries is something which we all go through the pain. Not during the initial installation, it's only at the later stages. Even if an escalator bell pawns off, we have gone through that. So until otherwise, there's an over consensus in terms of a sustainable usage and a solid and a robust technology is given, I think everyone is going to be very cautious on that. Second, in terms of the commercial building which we have, I think the apps, QR codes based call button or even the RFID cards, which many of our centers have already, is something which needs to be improvised. Someone has come with this kind of solution which can be worked. For example, we have used the app based ordering for our food courts. All the food courts, if you go to any of our centers, are food-based apps. You can order through the app and no need to even go and wait in the cash card system or wait for paying your money in the queue. So these have evolved over necessities. Now, this is a necessity where everyone is going to look at and come with a solution for it, but not to use this opportunity as something which can be pushed. In retail, I don't see this as an immediate requirement as of now, but yes, for the office building and the other residentials, this is going to be the factor which needs to be considered.
Zulfiqar, what is your take on that? How sustainable do you think the touchless system would be in office buildings?
The question to me? Sorry, I missed you.
No, the question
to yeah.
It's touchless.
Yeah.
How sustainable?
KK, first of all, you know, the reason for touchless, if you look at, there is a fear in the minds of the people that this pandemic, this COVID virus is going to spread through the, you know, contacts. That is the fact, and that's there. But, you know, it has got two impacts. One is the long term and the short term again. Short term, yes, we have to address this touchless concern. And we have to see that how this can be incorporated to the existing building and how it has to be done even for the future building. Because I understand touchless may not be very expensive when compared to other solutions we are finding. Coming to the existing building, what we as builders or a real estate developer, we, you know, look at lift manufacturer is, there are many third party developers who is coming and giving solution for the touchless interfaces like QR code or RFID. Many solutions are coming forward, but the lift manufacturers is you know, not willing to give access to their software system, so that it will affect them. Okay, and then coming to the the going forward, we have asked all of our lift manufacturer to give that touchless option for our elevators. We believe it's not going to be expensive. That's my take on that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mukundraj. What's your take?
Yeah, I think like Mr. Mohan said, existing building, I don't think we'll be in a position to really migrate to them, because the lease terms are already agreed to for the next 3 years. There may not be a scope for any further. I mean, in fact, it can be a negotiation for a reduction or a rebate over the next 2-3 years with the way some of the organizations are working and some of the industries are currently in. So there may not be much of a movement towards, I would say, changing over the existing facilities into touch-free type of things. But the new buildings, definitely at least 2-3 categories of buildings, like whether they could be buildings built for captive consumption, corporates building, making buildings for their own captive consumption, or the built-to-suit, where beyond a point, they look at more as a life cycle cost of that particular building and the facilities. People will move into the touch-free type of panels and other things, but leased spaces, multi-tenanted spaces, I think it will still take some time for the technology to become viable and to be also available indigenously for supply as well as servicing it before people really start moving en masse into adopting this technology. But yes, 4, 5, 6 years down the line, maybe that would be the way everybody would start using the vertical transportation systems, or for that matter, most of the facilities require a human interface.
Thank you, Mr. Mukund. Mr. Jatin, what's your take on that?
The touchless technology is going to come because in coming future, whoever are the elevator manufacturers, if they are able to, you know, embrace the innovation in the overall scenario and navigate the entire stuff, it's going to be they are going to be in demand. So today also, unfortunately, in the country, we don't have most of the manufacturers who have moved towards, say, a destination control system. So we are still going to rely on this technology is coming from other manufacturing hubs, be it in China or in Thailand or Switzerland or wherever, right? So yes, we need to take a balanced opinion on cost benefit analysis. But my take here is that overall, on a construction cost, the elevator is only about 2-3% of the overall construction cost for any developer, or maybe, you know, this also. So this component of touchless technology, which we're talking about, or we are talking about any other technology or any other antimicrobial surface in terms of change of the elevator finish, which we're talking about, or including air curtains or UV rays, or improving the filtration capacities in the air blowers inside the elevators, all this technology overall, what is that impact going to be on the cost? Possibly on an overall project cost, it might be quite small to embrace that. And this demand for technology will increase. More and more tenants will demand for that. And if there are two buildings to choose from, tenant will A will move to the building which is able to give this technology or this comfort, because hygiene is going to be a key factor in coming days. So this, we will have to look forward to embrace the technology. That's what I feel, and we should be ready for that.
Thank you. And Mr. Nilesh, what is your take? Because will that change the way the lobbies are perceived? Touchless technology, the lobby designs will change?
Yes. So currently, the level of development which is available on these technologies, the contactless kind of ways to call a elevator to give a program on the floor that we have to reach, the QR code thing, that's taking quite longer. I believe that that's going to get developed, and that may slow down or cut the amount of time that is getting integrated within the time the person calls for it and he gets into an elevator. But with some amount of improvement, of course, these systems will start getting integrated in their designs and the lobbies will cater to it. That's obviously going to be the next thing that's going to be there, but it needs some development to happen on those programs and the softwares to happen a bit more better to start getting them implemented.
Thank you, Mr. Nilesh. Mr. Rana, what is your take on that?
I am for automation. I only worry about every time I always think of B grade and C grade cities. Only thing is educate. One is the, you can implement it, but how to educate? The more problem is sometimes is education to all these, the areas where we have, population. Lifts are there everywhere now. If you say even a house has a lift, a four-story apartment has a lift, in Bhopal also has a lift, Indore also has a lift. Punjab also has a lift. So only thing is like how much implementation and how much education you will do. It'll take time, but I think I am for automation. It has to happen, I agree. All the way, we have to get into this and we have to learn this. Like we are learning other things, we have to learn this also. It should be part of life now.
Thank you very much. And as I conclude my questions and hand over the rest to Anita, I would like to just make a conclusion that I think everybody is optimistic that this is going to be a passing phase, and in the next couple of months, we will get back to a normal with some new identities and ways of life. I think technology is going to help us mitigate most of our issues. And I think we should be prepared to manage ourselves much better. And I am hopeful that the elevator market and the real estate industry will continue to improve in the next quarters. And over to you, Anita, for the next balance questions.
Anita, you're on mute.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yes. Yeah. My question is more from a expectation from the elevator industry. Like we spoke about various things on the requirement and the demand and the cost, and we were also looking at, people are looking at touchless products now, so which is not available everything here. So there is a lot of things which needs to work between the buyer and the seller. I would like to ask you all, what is the expectation in a given scenario like this you have from the elevator industry, which I'm sure will be a good takeaway for our listeners to understand that what the architects or the builders expect from them at this point of time. So if I can ask Mr. Mohan to start with.
Request all my lift manufacturers to come out with a cheapest solution to solve this problem. I will only say one line: come out with the cheapest robust solution and which can be serviced in India. Because every time I find that, okay, this component is going to be imported from China, this is going to come from here, and then finally we find, yes, it is all put together, but when it comes to the service, it is its first thing is the cost is not cost impact is there, then it's a service impact is also there. So let them come out with a solution in this scenario that the touchless technology at the cheapest cost, and the preferably which is maintainable also by the local service people also. That will be my request to all my friends of the elevator manufacturers.
Mr. Kumaran, what would you say?
Yes, So one would be that being service oriented and even to maintain the same level of service which you were doing pre-COVID to post-COVID or during these stressful times. Everyone is going to put pricing pressure. That is going to be coming from a few of the guys who are sitting along with me and many of the people who are going to deal with them on a continuous basis, even if it is going to be the gained opportunity from China, which everyone tells that India is going to gain a lot because of this in terms of manufacturing and also making India opportunities. The request should be that there should not be any change in the quality delivery which was done before. Maybe it should be the best or at par with one of the imported information here. I don't see any reason that it should be otherwise. And also, last point would be the technology. Make the technology available to the end user and also reduce the operating costs.
Mr. Mukund Raj, please.
Definitely, I mean, we would look at the elevator manufacturers to now start, even they start now, a couple of years it will take for them to establish manufacturing facilities in India so that whatever the state-of-the-art technology elevators, which currently the elevator manufacturers are getting them delivered from China, wherein they are able to get the advantage of a lower cost of production. I think a similar thing needs to be simulated in India with facilities so that one is, it definitely helps getting into the Make in India scenario, make it more digital, make it more technologically driven stuff. So India has the capability, India has the potential. It's just that the manufacturers need to repose confidence into the local industry and set up the facilities. And once they do that, then the supply and subsequent maintenance over the life of the elevator, if that facility is going to be available by the elevator manufacturers in India, I think there's nothing better that can be done. We can forget about importing from Europe, Japan, or China, or other parts of the world, and be always dependent on them for spares, for upgradation, for various other things of the lifts. So I think we need to become self-sufficient and be able to manage ourselves. I think that's what the elevator manufacturers need to use the COVID period as a catalyst, as something which is forcing them to work in this particular direction.
Yeah, Mr. Jaykumar, lot of our Indian companies already have all these, manufacturing facilities here, some of the large ones. So don't you see that as an opportunity to source it from them and also see that we don't really need to depend on outsiders because that capabilities are already there in India here?
Yeah, like what I mentioned earlier, yes, capabilities are there. But again, the components also many, at least 50-60% of the components are imported. I second the thoughts of Mr. Mukund Raj that the dependency of this industry on the other countries should reduce. I think we should become wholly Make in India. I think that is supposed to come and we expect that to come in short. I think that is something that has to be looked into because we don't have to depend on anything because if I ask for some correction, some addition, something, always there is a time lag to get the response because they have to wait for some component has to come from the different country. That is number one. And coming to the current situation of this COVID-19 and the impact on this, I request the elevator manufacturer to give solution to our existing elevator. How do they know? Tie up with the third-party developers for this app-based solution for touchless. I think they have to come as a solution jointly rather than be individually talking to the third-party solution seekers. And in the long term, the new lift what they are coming, I expect them to find solution for this touchless with their own model, and they have to give a solution to that. Apart from the touchless, other demanding factor in the COVID scenario is The people also look for a very hygiene condition of the lift core. When I talk about hygiene condition of the lift core, it is the indoor air quality of the lift core. In very less, because the lift core indoor air quality is, you know, it's a link to so many things. It's linked to the lobby indoor air quality. It is linked to the lift shaft indoor air quality. It is linked to the lift machine room indoor air quality. So there should be a collective thought, how do we, you know, address all those things and then improve the indoor quality. And another thing is the material used in the lift core, particularly, you know, it should not be more VOC contributor, be it an adhesive you use or be it a paint or a coating, whatever you use, you know, the VOC component should be less. That's my, you know, request to the lift manufacturers. Hello? You can hear me?
Are you all able to hear?
Yeah, now we are able to hear you.
Yeah. Okay.
I finished my comment. You can.
Okay. I think I'll ask Mr. Rana.
Yes, I think overall, if you see, I think we have to go for more and more automation. That is one part. Second part, as Mr. Jayakumar said, we have to think of some very good innovative interior material for the lift cars. In terms of, like, not only this COVID-19, tomorrow maybe there's another virus coming, they will continue to come. So what I mean by that technology is that in my car inside or at the door entry point, I should have a provision of chemical showers, fumigation showers. Inside the cabin also, with the press of the button, I should be able to activate. Like this kind of scenario, if it comes, the lift closes, I just press the button and start this fumigation system, start this COVID-19, COVID-20, COVID-21, everything goes off, doesn't matter. So that should be the part of integrated technology now for you guys, that okay, lift car should be good for all times. That is number two. Number three, when I say the growing industry, this warehousing is a very growing industry now. Handling the cartons from China, handling the cartons from Europe, handling the cartons from everywhere, it is becoming a task these days. So that, I think your lift cars are there. I think many manufacturers are there for the industrial lifts. They are big lifts. But this kind of scenario, how to tackle, how to, you know, sterilize these guys, how to, you know, handle them correctly. That we are doing 2-3 warehouses, we are finding it very difficult. There's not much technology available in the market for the lift guys. They are giving very rough kind of lifts. Okay, this is the lift 3 meter by 4 meter, but doesn't have much of system inside to, you know, fumigate, to sterilize the system, to cartons handling. So those kind of thing can be, I think, maybe more innovative, can be done on the warehousing and industrial lift also.
Okay. Mr. Nilesh, would you like to add anything further?
Yes. So we know about these ways of touchless ways of trying to operate onto the elevator is the new thing. Whether the manufacturers themselves will be able to come up with the solutions for this and let us know what is the best way that this can be dealt with. Rest of the points, I echo whatever Mr. Jayakumar and Rana has also said, that we look at the surfaces, we make them something which is going to be easy to maintain, something which is going to be permanent, which can look at having some disinfections measures that can be operated on them, and this becomes integrated with the elevator itself. So what is it that the elevator industry as a whole, these manufacturers can offer, which we can then start integrating within the buildings? And that's the food for thought that we have.
Okay. And Mr. Jatin?
Yeah, I have a couple of points for the elevator industry. Basically, from a project management angle, there are we have been always able to embrace new technologies. We have always been able to get new elevators or good elevator system designs from all the manufacturers. And they've been all forefront and supporting us also to offer a better elevator. What we find challenges is most delivery installations. And now I think we need to, with this current scenario where the labor dependency is going to be more and more across all the projects, and there will be demands and shortages of laborers, skilled laborers who are not possibly going to come back or, may not be available. We need to look at new technologies of installation, might be a scaffoldless construction or might be any other construction which is possible at the at no additional pricing. We are also looking, as everyone else said, Indianization or bringing in all those technologies back to India for manufacturing. Maybe not focusing only on one area of setting up an industry, but possibly because of the current situation, what we are seeing, possibly also investing in two different locations or three different locations within the country for elevator manufacturing, if it is financially feasible. Depending on more backend suppliers, or rather not only just a few suppliers to supply motors or other parts of the elevators to reduce the, again, those dependencies. So that's the second point of that. Apart from, yes, embracing all the innovations which we have spoken during the last 1 hour of discussions, possibly getting new ways of monitoring the actual usage of elevator in this scenario based on IoT or based on or arriving at new thumb rules of how many elevators are required for a particular usage. So this all studies need to be conducted over the next couple of months in the next coming months to see what's real impact on the design of the elevator per se, or the number of elevators per se, or the speeds of the elevator per se. So these are my takes, apart from everyone who have put in their thoughts on this platform.
That's great. I think I'm sure there is a lot of thought which you have given to the elevator industry. And before we end, I just want to close it on a positive note. And I hope all of you are as positive as we are. And just wanted to know your point of view on when do you think the industry will bounce back? What is that we should be looking forward to? So if I can ask Mr. Jaykumar first.
Yeah, industry bounce back. Yes, as we all anticipate, it's going to happen in a phased manner. If you look at in Bangalore conditions, we already started our project construction in a couple of our locations in Bangalore. Mm-hmm. And in Hyderabad, they started since yesterday. And we expect Chennai to open up very shortly. This is going to happen in phase by depending on the geographic location and the impact of the COVID, these things. Coming to the normal, to the what it was, 50 days ago, probably it will take some more time because the whole lot of, supply chain, the whole lot of, the complete cycle has to be, reactivated. Probably that will take, after the vaccination, proper vaccination is invented for this. It, in my opinion, it is somewhere between 9 to 12 months is what I look at.
Okay. Mr. Mohan, what would you say?
I think this is a $1 million question. And I don't think so anybody has a definite answer for this. Because the whole cycle to get reactivated is a big question mark, when it can happen and when the people will be start using the offices the same way we were doing or going for a holidays and airlines starting, restaurants starting, pubs and clubs starting. It's all depends on when we have a vaccine and when it is become effective and the people get a confidence that yes, if I go and shake hand with somebody, I'm not going to get taking home the corona. So it's a $1 million question. I think I will not have an answer for this. How much time it will take? Maybe a year, maybe 2 years. I don't know. But I'm expecting at least by mid-21, we should be through of this.
Okay. Mr. Mukundraj.
Yeah, I mean, timeline, Anita, I think, as Mr. Mohan Abhichandani said, difficult for anybody to predict. Nobody is able to know or say what would be the extent and the duration of this pandemic. Even today, things are very, very uncertain. But while I say this, in real estate, if I look at the three main asset classes, the residential, commercial / IT and the retail. Residential, because again, it is a very discretionary spend, plus a lot of people are losing jobs. There are pay cuts happening in various industries. So for some time, definitely there is discretionary spend will take a backseat compared to the other priorities for a particular individual, whether it is for an end use or as an investor. So, but then, ultimately, I expect as soon as you start the ebbing of this pandemic happening, at least the affordable segment of residential, I am expecting this should pick up and it should come back to normalcy with a very short time lag. Luxury homes will take much longer. Commercial offices, again, a lot of mixed reactions coming in from people. But as I say this, one thing which I realize is a mixed-use development, a gated mixed-use development where you have a residential, commercial, educational, and a bit of convenient shopping and all that. If a large development has all these components within a short access, I think this is going to be the big draw in the coming couple of years. If there are mixed-use developments, I think they will move very, very well. Whereas standalone developments, very difficult to predict the timeline, but 21-22, I expect the market should bounce back much more stronger than the pre-COVID days. That's my prediction.
Okay. Mr. Jatin, what would you say?
I'm also of the same opinion that towards the Q3, you will start seeing the momentum being building up for commercial spaces. Mm-hmm. And yes, South, in South India and possibly in NCR, you can see a lot of developments happening around Q4. This will eventually lead to a lot of momentum to demand in residential market as well as in coming year. With the stress fund being established by the government and a lot of money coming in from Swabin Fund, I think there will be a demand which will pick up for all the stressed assets which have been there and the residential market on what you call as not so luxury, but mid-range segments will pick up. Eventually around Q4, you will start seeing those more. So we feel that yes, the industry is going to come back strongly around Q4. Yeah.
That's really encouraging. Mr. Kumaran.
I just wanted to tell that I'm an engineer, not an astrologer, but I can take guess out of whatever we are reading or what's happening in the countries which have gone through this couple of months before that. Like Mohan was telling, it's $1 million question, but I also feel that a lot of it depends on which state we are talking about. Let's be, it could be Maharashtra or some state where it's really affected. The catch-up is going to take a little longer, but not in the states which are not affected that much by this pandemic. The second, in terms of going back to the normal, it also depends on the government's pathway of economic trigger and the relaxation which they are going to give to many of the developers and also the industry per se. Commercial will be the first thing I think which will bounce back in terms of commercial space. In specific regions and sectors, but anywhere between 6 to 12 months is a rough guesstimate according to the reports which we read.
Fantastic. Mr. Nilesh, what's your point of view on how far we are and how long we will take?
Yeah, so that's a difficult question to answer, Anita, and thank you that you're reserving it for the last. So my estimate from whatever I feel is that it's Q2 that is going to be affected by the current pandemic, and by that time we will start improving. And it's Q3 when we start seeing movement, better movement, because it's also Q2 is also going to be monsoon. So the construction industry, availability of labor, all of these issues are going to be cropping up. People will restart, approvals will start happening again, mm-hmm. will start to reserve. So the momentum has to start building up. And from Q3 onwards is when we can see that we will start getting to a bit of normalcy. And next year should be good, but I see that it's Q3 when things start really moving ahead.
Okay, that's a good note. Mr. Rana, I think you're the one who's left now, and what is your positive
prediction? I agree with Nilesh. I think as architects, I think we are driven by our clients, Mr. Clients, all the developers, all the industry people. So anyway, we are ready with the drawing board. We are on the drawing board. And as a starting point, I think we are a small group. When we say Architects, it's a smaller fraternity. Right. To start with, we'll not take much time to gear up. But as long as our friends are ready, we are also ready.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Fantastic. That was a great session. You know, there was one or two questions which the attendees have asked. If I may take another 3-4 minutes of your time. And one question which I can see is for Mr. Jatin Shah. And someone is asking, that is Mr. Umesh Narula, who's asking, sir, don't you feel the elevator shaft should be pressurized or ventilation increased to reduce viral load, if any?
So I think the National Building Code already has the codal requirements of shafts being pressurized and the lobbies also being pressurized or ventilated. There are excessive demands, which we all spoke about, that yes, the elevator as a entire, everyone is looking forward to having more better air movement inside the elevator and possibly having more filtration within the elevator system per se to see to it that this situations are being under kept control. But the pressurization clauses are already there in the codes, and they have been aptly followed. On terms of degree of increase in the speed or increase in the ventilation capacities, that's something which we can eventually work with help of KK and air conditioning consultants to figure out if that will help eventually. Yeah.
Okay. There's another question which I can see. Mr. Manohar has asked, please address the concept and ideas you would implement or propose to complete projects ahead of time using other precast modular vertical horizontal construction. Less dependency on skilled and unskilled labor. Who would like to take that?
I can take that, Anita. I mean, if you are talking about commercial buildings, the new National Building Code, in fact, is making concrete buildings in offices actually becoming less viable with all the restrictions on the headroom, the beams, and all that. So in one of the projects, I mean, this was the last organization I was with, L&T, after a lot of thought process, we decided to change over an office building from a concrete building to a steel building. Now, the advantage of that, one is we had to rely on very less of labor on the site. Automatically, the social distancing and all taken care. Dependence on labor reduced. All the fabrication happening offsite, quality is assured. And the speed of construction was much faster. So maybe commercial buildings, as we go ahead, some of the study which has been done shows a steel building could be an answer. And I think the gap between the price of a steel building to a concrete building, I think that gap is also lessening over the years. So maybe that's one area where the time to complete a building could become much faster and with less relying on labor.
Fantastic. I think that we really short our time too much. So thank you so much for your participation and giving a great point of views. I think it was a great session for the elevator industry to hear from all of you and take back a lot of thoughts. So I once again thank all of you for being with us and taking this session and making it a success. Thank you so
much.
Thank you all. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.